So we're just getting started. We've drawn up. It looks like Tanner's going first. And we're going to open up with some foundations. So Steven's going to have to take a second to... he's not going to... Or no, he did form. He formed out... He formed out the short fuse, of course. So he does hit the sliding ankle breaker. That's going to flip... That's going to flip another card. So he's just going to, he's going to leave the always watching up. Not overly concerned about damage reduction. Yeah, that was actually really ballsy. I wouldn't want to be Steven if that play had failed like on stream in the first turn of his first game. that would have just felt so bad. Tanner is going to play the block here.
I got the casual buy.
Oh, nice. So we have Kevin here with us right now who got the filthy casual buy. He scrubbed out playing Sniper Joe.
Oh yeah, that was bad. I don't even want to go there. It was definitely the thing I was worried about, which was just those auto loss matchups in round one. I had to like side out my character every single game. It was just terrible.
Yeah. Welcome to Standard.
Welcome to Standard.
We're outside of Calgary. They play real decks. So we're gonna have a duration from Tanner. Pretty good timing on that. Steven doesn't have a caught red-handed up, so he's gonna need to revoke for the card draw if he wants to block this. And he's gonna go for the partial block, which is interesting. He's gonna commit Goro and just take the. He's gonna let Tanner just draw the three cards here.
For the stomp.
Yeah, they're gonna. It looks like they're calling judge to see who gets priority on the response chain here, whether he gets to respond with Goro before stop or not. So he is being allowed to respond with Goro before the stop trigger.
Yeah, turn player responses go first.
He's going to draw three cards off duration.
Yeah, it depends when those trigger windows are, though. I don't have the cards in front of me, that's...
I don't have the cards in front of me, but I'm pretty sure Goro gets to go before stop. I don't honestly know.
Goro says after your attack is blocked, then what is stop?
Stop is after you block an attack.
So they have the same window.
Yeah.
Same window, turn player gets theirs first.
Them's the beats.
Them's the beats.
So Tanner's got a nice handful of foundations at play. So he's gonna get the Rising Storm here. That's gonna let him block from his momentum, which is pretty good with the duration in his momentum. That from the looks of it, he's gonna have the plus one mid block, I think.
This is also round four.
Oh, this is round five. So this is round five. Winner's gonna get into top eight. We are just underway here with game one. And he's gonna play the cannonade with the Goro trigger here, because the Goro control check bonus actually applies to the next attack. Also, he does get to play that Sturmwaff on a 7 with plus 4 of the check. So he is gonna get some pretty crazy damage off this, from the looks of it. I don't know if Steven has a block for this. He does have a Templar.
He's got the Templar.
He's gonna get the... Oh, no, he's gonna fail that. Unlucky. That's a lot of damage.
That's a bad start for the first game.
Yeah. He gets pounded at the Waffle House. Now, Tanner pulling ahead here in momentum is a big deal. You really don't want Tanner, you really don't want Goro to be drawing cards off every attack. So we'll see. I would expect Steven to want to throw a poke here, just to get another momentum to be able to stay in the race with Goro. I don't know if he's gonna be able to stay ahead without playing really aggressively. If playing like hyper aggressively to stay ahead in momentum is the correct game plan, or if it's just to try to keep up with Goro as long as possible and then fall back to your own game plan here.
Yeah, hang back, gain life, play foundations.
So he has chosen his flip target. Oh, he is, and he's gonna get the spiders and dragons. He's gonna check the five on the throw, of course. Just kidding, he's not throwing. He is gonna go for the surveyor though, so he is gonna be behind in momentum now.
No, he plays safe.
He could have played the Death Valley. Oh, he is gonna. Thank you so much. So he is going to make Tanner take back the review draw, or the foundation. So Tanner's going to get a draw off 108. We'll see if Steven has a. I didn't see if he pocketed a low block for this. Possibly not, because I believe that. He's got a few low attacks in the deck, but most of the attacks in this Goro deck are high. So he is just going to block with the Templar for half. So Tanner is going to get to draw a card here off of Goro. And get plus two, and he's got plus two on his check. He's got the Cannonade and the Sturmwaff in his hand. And Steven does not have a Caught Red-Handed on board. He is going to go for the Cannonade. And that's going to check. So if this hits, he's going to get another Cannonade. Steven is going to have to probably just not block this. Like, either full block or not at all. I think a half block would be catastrophic at this point. So Steven's weighing his options here. He does have the full block. He needs to pass this on a 9, and he can't pass it. So he's gonna take 9 off this, and that's gonna net Tanner a Cannonade. If he remembers his trigger, he's not gonna remember his trigger. He's going to pass the Sturmwaff, though. And it looks like that's a concession here. He's checking for Dimitri. So he is going to have to mitigate this damage somehow. Because this is a 5 high for... Or no, he's at 9. Yeah, it sucks when you misplay on stream too, because then you're just like, somebody tells you, like, oh yeah, you misplayed on stream, you didn't pick up your Cannonade, I'm going to get to bug him about it later, and he's going to be like, yeah, I know. But he won't actually remember he did that. So he's going to get 4 damage off of the Sturmwaff. And get 2 foundations. That's going to net him 3 momentum as well. So he's gonna look for the Death Valley. He's gonna check a 3 on it. This game is looking pretty grim for Steven here. I don't know that he can count 33 through Goro before he takes 5. He's gonna look to gain some life back though. I mean, he almost recovered that hand too, by checking well on the throw. But at the end of the day, yeah, he did just fall way too far behind on that hand. And it looks like Tanner just canceled all of the damage on that. We are going to get the Tombstone Stunner, though. So he's going to take the block. He's going to fail the block. But he's going to respond Goro and take 3, I believe. Just going to put Steven up. Well, Tanner's tapped out, but I don't think Steven gets to put a whole lot of damage to punish him with. Mostly because like the check bonus from Tombstone Stunner is not going to be... I don't think that's going to be enough to pass another throw. Oh, he doesn't have one anyways. But it will put Steven to 9, which is not... he's going to gain a bunch of momentum here. So that's not going to be... I think he's still going to be behind by 1 momentum, maybe. He's going to take the Mathematician. The Mathematician's going to be good, too, for denying more momentum. And it looks like Tanner didn't get too far with his drawing attacks here. He's probably going to have to build. Oh, he's just going to swing anyways. So he's going to throw the Sturmwaff. He's going to take the Dimitri 5+ for the negative stolen. It looks like he's just going to try to mitigate damage here and gain the life back. So with Sturmwaff coming in on 2, and he's going to flip the Sturmwaff so it doesn't go to momentum. So it's going to net 1 damage. It looks from his hand. Oh, excuse me. It looks like he's probably pretty okay with that. He can just dump some foundations out and see what happens. I don't know that you want to disrespect a Dimitri too badly. Like you want to hold something to block with. I see a Death Valley, so he could potentially throw that. He's gonna throw the Death Valley. Oh, Tanner is going to use the Evil Imposter on the Death Valley to negate the life gain enhance on it. Or to remove the life gain enhance on it. If they tie, I believe neither of them get in. I mean, it probably depends heavily on the people underneath them. But the likelihood, like, if they tie, maybe one on strength of schedule. I don't know. I'm really bad when it comes to that. But I'd like, if one of them wins, for sure they're in. So I don't think either of them really wants the tie here. Have to look, they have that posted up on Facebook. We just did the quick Cliff Notes version of who was on the bubble. I mean, I just win all the time, it's fine. I don't win all the time. Yeah. 60% of the time it works every time. Yeah. But yeah, no, they have the full standings post up on Facebook and whatever of the groups. Steven's doing really well at checking Darkside Master on every card he plays this turn. Like that's he's approaching Garrett tier right now. Yeah, actually, I don't know if you almost all of them, dude. I don't know if you know this. Edmonton's nickname is the Oil City, or. That's correct, the Oil City?
Yeah.
Yeah, Edmonton's the Oil City. So having somebody from Edmonton playing Oil Man, not really that unexpected, honestly. So Tanner's just really desperately needs to draw like three attacks here. I don't think he got three attacks. He might have two. No, I think he has one. He got Iron Knuckle. That's not a bad start. Now he can just pound damage on it with. He's gonna destroy face down. He can just pound some damage on this with homemade explosives and see what happens. So Steven's going to grab his negative stolen back. He is going to block with the Templar, even though the Templar is going to seal itself. I can find out for sure. I only had like 30 seconds to look and pick, like, to get a matchup on here. Ideally we wanted a bubble matchup. And he's not going to gamble on the homemade explosives. Now the more that Steven lets Tanner build here, though, the harder it's going to be to actually punch through lethal damage. He's got a lot of fire foundations here that are going to reduce damage. So So it's going to take more and more resources to actually hurt Tanner. So he's gonna Surveyor for one of his throws back. Probably a Tombstone Stunner. The Great Canadian Border Wall.
Everybody has to kill my guy.
So he's got the Tombstone Stunner going. He's looking for the negative stun. He's gonna pick the dark side. That's interesting. So he's gonna blow his homemade explosives here for damage reduction, which is interesting. I would think that it'd be better to just go with the always watchings first, and try to hang on to the homemade explosives for offense. Try to draw into those cards to finish the game out. But he's pretty fearlessly just gonna throw them on defense. I mean, I guess he can just throw everything. So he's gotten the Tombstone Stunner to an amount of damage that he is happy with, I guess. Yeah, Steven's gonna have to punch really hard to get through Goro damage reduction. I think at this point they're basically playing the game where Tanner's trying to zero out the damage entirely, whereas Steven's just trying to make it hit for the momentum. But he might be committing way too hard to this. Oh, he has the death blow though. That could be really strong here. That's at least 21 damage, so that's not gonna be lethal on its own. But he does have the Cursed Fate, so he can push it up to, well, and then Goro response. It looks like he's only gonna hit 21. I don't know if he counted this out or not. Oh, he does have, and he has 2 damage off 8,000, I think. But Tanner has 2 Wall of Goros up. He's got an improved, I believe that's Unexpected Invitation. I think that zeroes out one of them. He's just going to straight block the first one. Yeah, that's not going to be lethal at all. He's going to use the Rising Storm to block with his momentum here. He pulls the mid block for the mid zone death blow, and that's going to be on a 4. So that's going to be a full block with breaker 1. Steven not in a very good position at all here. I believe Tanner could just use uninterrupted. Yeah, you could use Unexpected Invitation to return it to printed values. So he's going to take 0 from this one as well. Multiple copies, of course, and having 0 printed values on them. So he had those Wall of Goros on board. He didn't even need to use them here. But he really needs to draw attacks to close this game out and move on to game 2. And that just doesn't look like it's happening. You can see the frustration. He's had this game on lock for the last three turns and just can't end it. We're going to make sure we check all of our attacks while we're building our foundations, though. That's the Calgary way. So I see Steven has a couple of attacks here. He's got a Templar. He's taking a look at this uninterrupted or this unexpected invitation here. So he's gonna go for the always watching, the e-commit minus student. Oh no. Okay, so he is gonna go for the always watching. Interrupted education. Oh come on. There's two of those dumb Kyo 2-dot cards that almost nobody plays. There's two of them. I know there's two. There's another one that's like, you commit, discard a momentum, this attack gets -2/-2, and both players draw a card, or something dumb like that. I don't remember what that's called. Actually, I think that was Unexpected Invitation. So we're going to have the sliding ankle breaker here from Steven. He's gonna pick up a dark side. He's going to try again. You're right. I should at least have like UFS Ultra open on like a tablet on the side so that I don't sound like an idiot. You know, I should know the cards that I'm talking about.
You were right about Unexpected
Invitation. Oh, see, and I was right about Unexpected Invitation. See, I just mixed them up. I can even tell you Unexpected Invitation has a low block on it. So we play all the bad cards in Calgary, so it's fine. I see all this crap. So Tanner's gonna get a cycle here. Hope to God he or no, he's not even, no, he's still on the block phase. So he's gonna Wall of Goro on that and look probably take one. He's got another sliding ankle breaker here. So that's for 6 damage, I think. So Tanner's gonna drop that to 5. And he's just going to Wall of Goro and take one. That's going to put him at 20. Steven is not getting very far punching through this. He's going to Surveyor for the next sliding ankle breaker. He's going to pass it. Trying desperately to get any kind of damage on the board here. Any kind of meaningful damage, rather. I wouldn't call dealing 2 damage to Goro over the course of 3 turns incredibly meaningful. See, that's a thing though, Doug, is we're all bad players, so it's fine. It's really easy to call out like misplays when you get to sit on your high horse with a camera. So he's gonna interrupted education, thank you, for the return to printed and just take the three. Now I don't know how many turns Tanner can go here statistically without ever drawing attacks, but I feel like he should be coming to the end of that. I would like to think that. He's gonna hang on to the foundation though. Oh, he held on to the foundation. Because of the forbidden knowledge. So again, he's stuck. He's gonna build some foundations. He's gonna get mad because he checks attacks on them. Yeah, and I'm just the salty guy on the internet who gets to make fun of people who play games. It's fine. Yeah. Steve did make him pick that up with Mortal Knowledge. I'm sure every other player who played during the release of King of Fighters struggles with not calling it Forbidden Knowledge like the other card. Like, I've lost count of the number of people who also do that at this point, so I don't feel too bad about it. Tanner looking for Dark Sides probably there. And that's a handful of Foundations and Templars. Forbidden Knowledge was the OP stuff. I love Forbidden Knowledge. I was like, that card was so much fun. Probably broken, but it's still fun. It's like one of those cards that's like not broken in the sense that you look at it and you say, wow, that's broken, but you like play it in a couple of decks and you're like, wow, that was broken. I just got a flash from the hallway. That's hype. So Tanner, being at desperation now, can use his Yori's Orochi Bloods for damage reduction as well. He's running out of damage reductions to be able to throw into this, with Steven still basically just turning all of them face down. He's saying enough of that. There's a two, but he's got face downs, he's fine. He probably wanted to see that dark side anyways. He's got the three there, it's okay, we got more face downs. Let's throw him away. We don't need him. We got all these cool kid face up foundations play this turn. Oh, there's some attacks. See, now this is how we can finally end games. So now he can make Steven block a whole bunch of attacks here, and eventually one is just going to get through and kill him. He's going to flip the Yambarai with the Mathematician. He's going to Dimitri. He's going to grab the Dark Side Master. Not sure that's a really big deal, but don't know. Maybe he draws into a reversal here. We get some pretty chill late game UFS out of this game. He probably just wanted to mill himself with Dimitri, honestly. He's going to go for the Templar. That's going to get short fused. He's going to get plus 2 on his next check. Steven's going to take 2. Yeah, so he's at 3. I believe that should be game. Oh, is that a cannonade? I think that's a cannonade. Yeah, it's a cannonade. 3, 4, 5. He needs 1 to pass it. And does he have the high block? I do not believe he has the high block. Or the damage mitigation to mid block this. So if he half blocks this, he's gonna take 4, and then he's gonna portal barrier to 3. Oh, he can Templar though. Okay. And is he gonna pass it though? I don't believe he passes that. And that's the end of game 1. That was agonizing, honestly. That was a whole lot of I think Tanner had that one like 5 turns ago.
Was it agonizing for you?
Just
imagine.
All right. Yeah. This is why damage reduction walls are so much fun to have in standard.
Yeah, that was the longest game of the day.
Was it?
Hands down. First game today I think that we did was like close to
Oh yeah, that one's decently long too. That was like exciting back and forth though.
Yeah,
this was just like waiting 5 turns for Tanner to draw attacks because he can
like
just deal with throws all day.
Be like 5 minutes away from round over.
Yeah, they might only get 1 game out of this.
Exactly.
21 minutes.
That
is a really weird time to call it, but that it is also 7. He's prone to doing weird things like that. It's part of the character. I believe they have 20 minutes for game 2.
23 minutes and 48 seconds.
So I see Steven throwing some Kersplats in here. That's going to be interesting. He's going to have he can make the reversal play. That'll be fun.
So if this ties,
If it ties, it depends. I think they're 2-2. I don't know what I would have to double check what their record was. But if they're 2-2, a tie is probably bad. If they're 3-1, a tie is fine.
Like in their other games they played
throughout. Yeah. We get to have another 20 minutes of exciting Goro on Dimitri action. Because if I have to suffer, you have to suffer with me. We're just shuffling up now. Hopefully Steven doesn't keep some kind of like, oh, he's Steven's just gonna, oh no, okay, never mind. I thought they were still cutting each other's deck. I thought Steven was being a troll and just putting the top 5 cards of the deck on the bottom, which I mean I would have done too because it's fun. He's gonna keep a 2 foundation hand. That seems risky. I mean, it didn't really go for him. I see he has a dark side in his hand. I don't know if that's the answer. Like, he's got to review something here. He's got to review an attack and hope he draws three foundations, and even that might not be good. Oh, he's not going to review anything. He's just going to hang on to it. Yeah, man. Like, I don't know. I wouldn't hang on to that either. That seems really risky. He's going to check it, though. He's gonna go for the dark side. Are we gonna have the UFS stream where we teach Steven to mulligan properly? Does that have to be a thing? He's just gonna throw it, yeah. I mean, Surveyor with dark side and momentum can't be the worst thing. But that was a full block. Was that full block? No. How the hell did he take no damage off that from a mid block? He's got the cannonade. Oh, did he check two earlier too? I mean, it's more complicated than that for some decks, but yeah, generally if you're six hand size and you have two or less foundations and you don't pop off with six or two with two or less foundations. Oh, we're talking shit about Steven not mulliganing on two foundations. And this is gonna get immortalized forever on his Twitch channel that he did this. It's gonna be awesome. He's gonna have to live with this for the rest of his life. For the rest of his Twitch channel's life. So Tanner's gonna pop him in the face with a cannonade. That's not the worst thing to have. I mean, he has a cannonade to do it again next turn, so that's always fun. He's got a Sturmwaff here too. This is like running it back from game one. So he's gonna have a 5 high for 9 here. That's gonna hurt. So he's gonna gain a life from negative stolen, but he's gonna drop to 16. And Tanner not taking the cannonade for momentum. Although, upon reflection, I don't think he can actually spend the cannonade from his momentum in this deck. So we're gonna have the ankle breaker here. He's gonna check for Dimitri. Probably grab dark side. Maybe grab negative stolen. Hard to say. Goro's tapped down from stop, so. Oh, he's gonna grab spiders and dragons. That's hype. So Tanner's gonna bury the damage here. Now, that was a good call. He's gonna go for the stunner. So that's gonna be on 3 damage. Tanner being nice enough to update his life on the counter for the stream, of course. I'm sure you do. I'm glad you could join us to watch Steven not mulligan two Foundation hands and check a bunch of dark sides.
Oh, so I missed good stuff.
Yeah, you're missing the good stuff. And then Tanner not drawing attacks for five turns. Fantastic UFS all around.
This is top shelf playing, mm-hmm. People. Top shelf. Is it game three now?
This is game two. Tanner's up one.
Oh, wow. This is still game two. Okay.
Yeah. And they have, what, 15 minutes left?
I don't even know if they have that much. Yeah. Not very much.
He's going to go for the portal barrier on a five. That's going to be four. You can probably commit mathematician for this.
Oh, that's what you get for playing border barrier.
Yeah, he's going to commit mathematician. Oh, Doug says hi.
No.
So we're going to have so Tanner's going to open up a spine sweep here. That's going to be a decent damage low attack. But Steven's going to grab he's going to get his Dimitri, so he's going to get his negative stolen. This is some damage mitigation. Yeah, he's going to, okay, he gets 8,000 off. It's going to go to 4. He can portal barrier it to 3. Oh, he's going to 8,000 it back up to 4, or back up to 5. They're gonna cancel each other out. He's going to portal barrier down to 4. Gain one from negative stolen.
13-21.
Steven just no selling that attack, like. Oh, and we have the cannonade. We have the cannonade. That's a, I believe that's a five.
That's rude.
So we're going to see him get punched.
I think this is a pretty big turning moment for this game right here.
I think this matchup pretty heavily favors Tanner.
Yeah, I think
so. Just by virtue of him not being allowed to block anything ever.
What card are we seeing right now?
Cannonade.
So he's playing Cannonade with a K.
Can you block the Cannonade?
And that's going to be failure on portal barrier, maybe? Or he might commit for it. Oh.
That's risky.
Commit Dimitri, dude. Commit Dimitri. So. He's going to retroactively use the caught red-handed there. Didn't realize that. Tanner waving his hands furiously here. He does that a lot, but you can never tell if he's happy or upset.
He's usually beating himself up.
Yeah. I mean, sometimes he's dancing.
Does that put 8 and 21, eh?
Yeah. So it's a grim future for Steven here.
Empty his hand?
Yeah. He's just going to sit on Wild Gore or Evenal Imposter and see what happens. He's going to drop the cannonade.
He's feeling pretty confident.
I think he probably could have taken that cannonade to momentum just to come out ahead on the momentum race. Really depends on how badly he wants to, like, cause
Dimitri takes the two life. Oh, no, he's changing his mind.
No. He's decided Wall of Goro needs to die. He's not wrong.
He might be going in.
He's going to pick something up. He's going to pick up... He got a sliding ankle breaker.
Do you think he can put lethal on board?
I think he's got a tombstone in hand. Could be wrong. That could be Death Valley. It's either Tombstone or Death Valley.
It's going to be really hard for him.
That's Tombstone. He's going to donk it, though. It's fine. So Tanner's going to Evil Imposter on that, so he does not get the check buff to his next throw. I don't know that really matters here. Because he's not going to block it, so it's not going to get the damage.
He might just be concerned about long strings.
True. We do have more information than he does. So he is going to pass the sliding ink breaker. He's going to throw another four on board, or another four. But he has nothing to follow it up with. He gets a Patriot stance. Oh, does it get the damage and not the check on block? Yeah. My bad. I know, I thought for sure Tombstone got the check automatically.
Thumbs up from Tanner, so.
It's alright, Tanner's just... Oh, he's got Wayne Brady.
He's got Wayne Brady.
Oh, this might be game.
We'll have to see how
this could be game.
I believe Steven does have a stop in hand.
That's not going to matter if... Oh, he can grab that. Is he going to grab that?
He grabs it.
He RFG'd that, though. He doesn't have to RFG that. Yeah. That gets destroyed. So he does get the free... He does get the Waffle House. And he's going to pass the Spine Sweep. He's in desperation, so Orochi Blood is only good for damage reduction. And so Steven's going to pass the... He's going to pass the Dimitri E. He's going to grab negative Stolen. That's going to be worth a decent amount of life with Patriot Stance. I don't know that it's going to be enough.
7 minutes left in the round.
And he's going to stop on it. Now, of course, that's going to pump one Goro attack to hell. He's going to get four. He's going to take three and gain two. He's going to respond Patriot.
I think I'm at nine.
He's got Wayne Brady. That could just kill him.
Yeah, I think Wayne Brady to the...
I think Wayne Brady on a two is the play here.
Yeah, Brady to Waffle.
Yeah, there he goes.
Yeah, you're doing the Brady Waffle.
So that's 7 damage choke throw.
Unmodified, he gets the
unmodified. Oh, he gets the unmodified. That's bad.
That's bad.
That's bad for Steve. So we have a 7 damage choke throw on board that he's gonna immortal knowledge
minus
that
one.
For minus 1. He's gonna plus 1 it with 8,000. He's probably gonna minus 1 it with 8,000 as well. He's going to go for the block. Oh, he's going to hold on to the 8,000. Goes to 3.
Goes to 3. The Storm Waffle should...
Yeah, Storm Waffle should be lethal here. Oh, he's going to get the stun. Well, he's going to commit. He's going to commit 8,000, but it's not going to matter.
Yeah.
He has the low block. That is game. So Tanner is going to go to top 8 with Goro, for sure, I believe. And, unfortunate for Steven. Dimitri does usually just lose to aggressive character abilities.
Yeah. Decks that don't rely on staging or anything.
Yeah.
And Goro just runs over anything that's not prepared for it.
I don't know that it was a matter of not being prepared for it. I think it was just more a matter of He did a good job of keeping control of the momentum situation.
Yeah, I did good there.
He did great there. I think he crippled himself on his first turn build both games, which was not good.